he has come from, no, he has actually, he will be discussing some things about his cube experience, as well as about something about his school, which he's actually doing work now.
Yeah. Friends, I will not take long time. I'm a unable to locate it.
It's up here.
Okay.
Slide show, start from
first. Friends, let me start with a small introduction about myself. My name is Surjit. Full name is Thokchom Surjit Singh. Surjit is the easiest part of my name to remember it. I'm from Shillong. I was born and brought up in Manipur. And right now I'm based in Shillong. I'm so excited, fully inspired, got a lot of new ideas, and my presentation is not necessarily about my work, but it is about the inspiration drawn from you in the last 72 hours. And I'm no more Surjit of yesterday. I'm a new person after I have seen, I have experienced, I have interacted with a young mind in cubes, as well as some old minds. I was a teacher. Very good teacher, so I left the school. I teach it for 12 years in a higher secondary school. Initially, I was teaching in class 9 and 10. So I was given punishment because I asked the children to ask question and they started questioning it. So I was pushed down to lower classes in class 5, 6, and 7. And it was way back in 1998-99 that I started knowing well that mathematics itself is a language, is not necessarily a subject. So to teach mathematics is not about teaching Hindi or English, it is teaching about a completely different set of languages. That was how I have traveled up to now. So I'm an evolving person, as immature as any one of you. So please don't expect so much perfection from me. I work in Khasi Hills, especially in the rural area. And we run education to make it accessible, meaningful, and affordable by the so-called poor people of India, with whose heart level we are all benefited and we are all privileged. We, for a long time, work it as a revolutionary, and we try to reject everything of what is available. But today, we are a little bit transformed or reformed. We do accept certain things, and we try to negotiate within the structure. So we accept the Constitution of India. accepting the Constitution of India as a person from the Northeast has a lot of significance. Particularly the tree spirit, equity, equality, and social justice. And we also accept a national curricular framework 2005, particularly the constructivist paradigm. National curricular framework 2005, I translated it in two languages. One is in Manipuri, other one is in Khasi. Khasi was not supported by government, and Manipuri version was well paid for the translation, and it was never make it accessible by the teachers, so I don't think people read it, but I did translation. And all what I came to know is that it was all cut and a paste book. It doesn't have so much coordination between the first chapter and second chapter and third chapter. So thank God that we have such a curricular framework. We also can pick up in an uncoordinated manner. So we do accept it. We do accept NCERT syllabus with a lot of reluctance. Beyond syllabus, there is textbook, there is classroom teaching, there is evaluation system. So we jump to the evaluation system as at least a part that we cannot challenge it now. But the textbook and the teaching methodology, the pedagogy, we have not used it as a workable model. So we do some certain basic small changes. One is work-centered education, work not for earning money, but work to get joy, work to build up cognition, and work to build up hope. And we also propose for a home-to-school and a school-to-home continuity, home-to-society-to-school and a school-to-society continuity. If a dialogue doesn't exist between these two sets of these resources, learning is impossible. Cognition is impossible. If we are not having space to question what is happening in the kitchen, there is no space at all to build up cognition. We also disagree the partition of the physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics, social science, languages. We try to de-partition it. And we take science, mathematics, social science, particularly these three subjects, as a language learning, switching over from basic interpersonal communication skill to cognitively advanced language proficiency. So when we learn science, we do start it with what do we call it in our common languages, and why do we need a new words? How do we specify it? All those things we advance it. And the most important thing is that whoever who doesn't question it have not learned anything. So whether the child really questioned to us in such a way that we became so uncomfortable, then in our own uncomfortability, we all the time try to have a sense of celebration. So a comfortable teacher, an enjoyable teacher who doesn't face challenges from the students is not at all a lucky teacher. It's a very unfortunate teacher. The pictures on the other side is our learning site. This is a private forest given to us for the next 10 years. And a close-up photograph is on this site. This is how our learning is conducted. This is our learning site. We conduct classes in the open field. And we also have tent to take shelter when rain comes. If it is too hot, we also use umbrella. But this is the way we conduct classes. Let me go ahead. These are some of the pictures. We do it. These children are planting trees, planting vegetables. But please don't take it as a farm work. Prior to this exercise, there is a lot of classroom exercise, collecting seed, studying about the seed coat, and then referring to the available textbook, and trying to understand what does it mean by radical, what does it mean by plumule, or what the book says about germination. All these things has done it. Then after that, they have built up a hypothesis that let us have the opportunity to disbelieve these books, and we'll start from there. So this is how we engage with them. And some of the photos, I'm unable to put the video because somehow my computer doesn't function it well, so I could not put the video. the lower portion is for tree studies, and the earlier one is looking for insects. And these are some of the photos available in my computer right now about how we collect butterfly, insects, the leaf studies, and all these things. Perhaps before these, how do we learn it? How do we know children are learning it? When the children ask it, what is the name of this tree? I really don't know. So we say, we ask it to the children, how will you get it, the name of this tree? So they went to the elder people in the society. And the elder people in the society, one of them will say, the name of this tree is Soringham. And Soringham is in fact the name of the village. So we say, ask one more person. So we ask the second person said the same thing, and keep asking it for as many people as possible. All of a sudden, we discovered that the tree has another name also. And then we search it, why this name is given in relation with this village. And then we started looking for the botanical name of this tree. So we went to the Botanical Survey of India and find it very difficult. Sorry to say, but they're all scientists, but to meet them is as difficult as any prime minister of any country. And finally, with all effort, we pulled them in the forest, only to realize that they themselves don't know the name of the scientific name of the trees. And we have been thinking about what to do, how will we collaborate it. In CUBE, we find hope, we also find the possibilities of collaborating it for meaningful learning for children. For us, our children, knowing that we don't know the name is a pride for us. It is not that, earlier some of my colleague was very worried that if they know that we don't know, then will we compromise the dignity? Will our children stop respecting us? But we now realize that the children's respect to us is double-folded now. So this is some of our experience. Now, the way forward. With CUBE, I have been talking with my colleague, and we are thinking of restructuring our approach in our school. This school, before I go forward, please don't think this school as a normal school. This is a school within the school. We work it with around 200 plus private and government schools. And within this school, we try to penetrate it. But for years, we try our level best, but we are not in a position to mature to a level. So therefore, we are now running a separate institution for dropout children. We say dropout children because it is very difficult to build up confidence for the elite's parents, and they will normally don't send children to us. So we pick up the left out children, and we are practicing it. But our children also go to the other schools, and they volunteer it to demonstrate many of their learning. Here, after observing for the last several hours. In fact, 2 months back, we already formed a CUBE team in our school. But then how to activate it, how shall we go forward? We're not very sure about it. So we thought that, okay, let Surjit visit, attend the session, let him come back, then after that, we'll reactivate once again. That is how we planned it now. So, one thing that has been significantly influenced me a lot was about connecting learning with research. Then, secondly, make learning a collaborative exercise beyond border. When we say beyond border, I'm talking about the intergenerational border. Normally, a child of 12 years and a child of 18 years and a child of a person of 30 years and a 50 years old person normally don't collaborate it. We maintain a hierarchy, and it is a one-way flow of knowledge, just like rivers, upper course, middle course, and the lower course. And in CUBE, I can see a spirit of the free flow of the knowledge from young to the old and from old to the young. So that we would like to carry forward to our institution. Collaborate with CUBEs. I find all CUBEs very enthusiastic. very good in heart, very challenging, and full of knowledge. So please come help us, as well as please learn something from us also. Now, the fourth one, CSRT, cube. Now, in our institution, we have a four levels of interacting with people. We all the time start with compliment. If we don't know how to thank even our enemies, we cannot negotiate it, so we compliment it. So we will compliment cube, but complimenting is not simply saying thank you, or complimenting is not something, something to say you are good, or complimenting is not something submitting to you. Complimenting means questioning you. Complimenting means sharing with you. Complimenting means not allowing you not to be critical about ourselves as well as about you by us. So this is our first task. So you can expect that myself and my team will be critically complimenting you very soon. And next S is supplement. This is our established approach. Whenever we compliment something, we all the time try to find out certain amount of the loophole where we can contribute it. So one of the contributions we can do it to CUBE is connecting with the younger people. I find undergraduate students too good for me to call you undergraduate. I find you nothing less than a grand, celebrated scientist. So we would like to build up a supplementary input from our children, and you can supplement us also. The third one is reformation, reformative. Nothing works without reforming. And the nothing comes without reformation towards transformation. So the last one is transformation. So we would like to get transformed mind because of your collaboration with us. Use maximum technology for collaboration. This is what I learned from CUBE. We will be doing it quite a lot of the technology very soon. There is a tendency for parents not to make smartphone accessible to the younger children. I now realize that this is a wrong approach. So let me negotiate with the parents so that they can get mobile smartphone accessible for learning purposes. Make high science doable and affordable. In fact, I was quite impressed with Sir's intervention yesterday about expertise. I now realize that science is not so much about big building or so much about a complicated instrument. It is more of our approach, more of our mindset, and more of our collective endeavor. So that CUBE will be a leading role for us to look at. And lastly, connect science with people. I have several other ideas, but I just want to put this much only. And please expect a student from our institute next meeting together. And please do plan to come to Shillong. The summer, the winter heat of the Mumbai is the summer heat of the Shillong. So right now, I came out from Shillong with jacket, only to put it with in my suitcase now. And now I'm enjoying the summer of Shillong. And the biodiversity and forest and virgin areas unexplored by the tourists, it will be all pleasure for me to invite you and give you time to spend together with us. Thank you.
Thanks for telling. Actually, we have a lot to learn from Meghalaya as well as several of the northeastern states. Unfortunately, we don't have so much of communication, and many people do not know in the mainland of the various things that are actually happening. And so when I went to Meghalaya, except for Shillong, or maybe some of the portion, the moment you go out of it, there's the cleanest part of India that you will ever see. Even if you visit a village, the way how the village houses are kept and the way how people go around there, the really, I mean, I can tell you, if there is anything that the entire India wants to make clean India, they have to emulate Meghalaya. very, very clean place. And I'm just telling my memory, based on your philosophy that you're talking about, you know, I have seen something, it just stuck in my mind, and I have taken a beautiful pictures of that, is a living bridge. They actually have a bridge of trees, you know, like our banyan tree kind of thing, you know, and that was like a complete mind change to me in terms of, you know, if you can actually make, and of course there are a lot of tree houses all around, which also is the case, and it's a paradise for butterflies. Absolute paradise of butterflies. So, I mean, I can see in the place where I was actually spending time to see the bridges, and the rest of the time I was only looking at the butterflies. Absolutely, it's not one, it's not two. I mean, it absolutely, you know, you'll be around, there'll be a large number of host plants and whatever is in the forest and things like that. And then one more memory I must tell is that it's a, when you, it's a lot of bamboo all around. Okay, so there is an enormous amount of noise of crickets. And then they make a lot of new music. It's not that, you know, it's just a continuous noise. They have rhythm. You know, they all, you know, go to high frequency together, collaboration. You know, at one go, and then they all silence, and then again they go up. So that reminded me of how fireflies also, you know, flash at the same time, and, you know, flash down and all that. I mean, I'm certainly tell you, if you, we will be very happy if you organize a conference, a cube conference there. We'll all go there next time.
Okay. Please.
And we'll don't worry about any facilities. We'll tent in that learning space.
Okay.
Yeah, except during the rainy season, the rest of the years are all comfortable.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks, Arjit. So we'll move to next presentation, which is of calling plant science group. This is a whole, because we have a lot of questions on, you know, botany and all those areas, botany areas, plant science. So. I think ma'am has to say, yeah, ma'am, come. So, okay, before that, we'll have one short kind of presentation by Tulasi ma'am, which is, she has come from Guntur, which is in Andhra Pradesh. Andhra Pradesh, yeah. So, she will be discussing about, you know, our Paglapose activity and about her work on Foldscope also.
Good evening, all of you. At Guntur also, with the inspiration from this cube, we have started Cube Curiosity Lab. And as right now Sujit sir said, I came with the same objective, but for me, there are two objectives. One is to introduce this amazing tool. The second is, first let me go and learn what is cube and what are the activities, so that I can prepare my students. So my students were not here now, but I'm here to introduce this tool and to learn from you. And in the beginning of the session itself, I'm confessing one thing. I'm also in the process of learning. So this is a participatory learning session. You can learn from me, I can learn from you. This is our mutual understanding. And I'm here today to introduce you a tool known as Foldscope. How many of you know about this? Earlier or yesterday? Okay, just forget about yesterday. Unlearn yesterday. Earlier? Oh, that's good. So I'm Tulasi from Government College for Women, Guntur. It's a default playing. Actually, I didn't know. It's default playing. The settings are different. It's okay. It's okay then. Keep it like that. Actually, I want to show one by one, but the settings in this laptop are different. The first one, it is not a greeting card. It is the image, the bunch of, what's the organism? The first one. Flowers. This, the bunch of flowers, image taken by Foldscope. So what's that flower maybe? Yes, exactly. That is verticella, and this is one verticella, you can see here. Oh. Black dog. Yeah. That is one verticella. You can see clearly the thread-like structure, bell animalcule, bell, cilia, and creating water current, taking food material, all that you can observe with Foldscope. So what is this Foldscope? You know all. What is this? A compound microscope we are using every day. And this is a Foldscope. Of course, both have their own advantages and disadvantages. So to compare, the Foldscope is very easy. It's like a bookmark. I'll keep in my book and I'll go to my class. So it is very portable, easy to carry. I can carry 20 Foldscopes in my handbag, whereas I can't carry a single compound microscope in my bag. And the maintenance is just a earbud is enough to clean your Foldscope now and then, maybe weekly once. Whereas for the microscope, we need to maintain a lot. And the number of lenses in the Foldscope is only one. It's a monocular microscope. And the magnification is our compound microscope, the magnification we calculate basing on the eyepiece and so the lens we used. If it is 10x, 10x into 10x, 100 we say. If it is 40x, 400 times and so. In case of Foldscope, the magnification with the naked eye is 140 times. And if we attach that, it can be attached to mobile. If you attach to your mobile, the magnification can be increased. For example, this is the small moss I have collected from the brick in front of Homi Baba Science Center. So you can zoom in, you can zoom out, increase the magnification. So the magnification with the naked eye is 140 times, but if you connect it, attach it to your mobile, it depends on your mobile capacity. Okay? And as I said, you can attach that to your mobile, you can take the photos, you can take the videos very easily. And this Foldscope is invented by an Indian-born scientist known as Manu Prakash. And the other name for this Foldscope is $1 microscope. And Manu Prakash called this as throw-away microscopy. So this can be used wherever you go. And I say it's the cost of a movie ticket and a popcorn. Yeah. Whatever, because as of now it is available on Amazon and Flipkart at 550 rupees. But once they launch in India, it may be, we may get it for 150 rupees, but as of now it is 550 rupees in India. So it is invented by Manu Prakash. Here I just want to add some about him just because you are curious cubist. Because the way you are asking the questions, the depth of the questions, the understanding levels, really it amazed me since morning I've been observing. And this Manu Prakash He's also like a curious cubist. He did his bit at computer science from IIT Kanpur, hail from Uttar Pradesh, and then he did PhD in applied physics from MIT, from computer science to physics, and right now he's working as biomedical engineer at Stanford. So look at the diversity, computer science, physics, biology. And that is about his. And he had many inventions to his credit, not only this Foldscope. You can Google, as the time is less, I'm not showing all those videos. You can have TED Talks by Manu Prakash on paper fuse. That is, again, another invention, a centrifuge, where the revolutions per minute is a lakh. Again, it is a very limited, less than a dollar price, made up of paper. In the childhood, we keep on playing with wiggling. We cut the thick, bound part of the notebook, we'll made it a circle, we'll place a hole in that, we'll play that. That is the principle he used to prepare that paper fuse. And this is Foldscope. There are many other inventions. And his dream is every biology book should have a last page as Foldscope, so that what the student learn in the book can be experienced. This is a Foldscope page. So if the textbook is supplied with this as last page, the student can prepare their own Foldscope from this, and they can observe what all they see in their textbook. That is his dream. I believe it's not far away, maybe a decade, that's all. All the biology textbooks definitely will have this Foldscope as a last page. And as I said, it is a microscope that can be assembled from simple components like a sheet of paper, some magnetic couplers, just because I am attaching this to mobile. When we are working at that magnification 500 times, 600 times, 400 times, a minute movement also affects. To avoid that, the magnetic couplers, so that the phone will be fixed to your Foldscope. So, and a lens. And he started this project in 2011, and the idea came to his mind when he was in Thailand. There is a big microscope, as that's why I said curious cubist. It is very expensive, and many people were afraid to use it because it is very expensive. If something went wrong, they may have to pay from their salaries. Then he thought, can I prepare a microscope which is affordable, which is cheap, which is versatile, can do many functions, which can do work even in field conditions wherever. So with that intention, he started thinking, and his Jim Sibulski, his PhD scholar, these two together, they prepared Foldscope. Now, Sibulski is the owner of CEO of Foldscope Instrument Company. So his aim is to prepare affordable. So as he said, it is $1. It is affordable to each and everyone. Versatile. Foldscope do many functions. First, it magnifies the things. It allows you to take an image. It allows you to take a video. You can project with that, and you can carry wherever you go. And it is sturdy. If you can throw this Foldscope, maybe the slide in this will break, but nothing will happen to the Foldscope. So it is sturdy. You can take wherever you go. In the field conditions also, you can work. So it is versatile. You can attach this to your mobile. You can take the pictures, videos. You can project the image with this. The same Foldscope can be used to project. In the first photograph, it is sturdy. So, and you can work in field conditions too. So Foldscope is this. This is Foldscope. But I'm showing this. So when you purchase Foldscope, it comes like this, a pouch with a paper and some couplers and lens. So you have to assemble this into like this, a Foldscope, usable Foldscope. But these are the parts of the Foldscope. So the intention behind this is to give to the student the ownership. I did this. I made the Foldscope. So to give that ownership, the Foldscope available as a paper, four parts, three magnetic couplers, one lens. So there are four parts. One is to place the lenses. This is known as lens stage. where we keep one magnetic coupler here, one magnetic coupler here, and a lens here. So this is known as lens stage. The second one is known as sample stage. This is one. This is the place where we keep our slide. So this is known as sample stage. This is panning guide. Means here, I can move my slide just like a microscope, up and down, sideways. So this is the part which allows you to move. That's why it is known as panning guide. And this is sample stage, the blue one, and the other side yellow. This is the place where you keep your slide. This is the slide. And this is the lens stage. And the next part is this one. Here you can see this. Focus ramp. That is like micro adjustment of a microscope. Once you could able to see the image, you can focus it very clearly so that you can take good image. So these are the different parts. And with this, you can assemble your own Foldscope. The videos are available on the YouTube. The videos are also available on the Foldscope official website known as Microcosmos. Or you can even get an instruction sheet in this. If you follow the instructions given in this paper, you can assemble your Foldscope. So we have a paper, glass lens, magnetic couplers, and an LED. Like this can be used to see, because to see something, you need a light source. A light source can be used to observe. Or you can prepare your own light source. And once assembled, this weighs 8 grams. These are the different parts of the Foldscope. So a pouch, 3 magnetic couplers, one coupler here, one coupler here, and the third coupler is for your mobile. Here. You can attach this to the camera. So you can take the images. So 3 couplers, lens, the 4 different parts, lens stage, sample stage, panning guide, focus ramp, the instruction manual, and a cover like this. Here. Each Foldscope consists of a unique ID number. It is there in this cover. That ID number is required to register yourself in the website known as Microcosmos. So you can see the objects up to 5 microns. There is a website known as Microcosmos, and that Microcosmos, you can upload your posts. If you want to see the posts uploaded by somebody else, you can. Everybody have access. It's just like Google. But if you want to upload your post, you need to register yourself. For that registration, you need to have your Foldscope unique ID. With this ID, you can register. Once you register, you receive a mail and password to your mail ID. With that, you can log in and you can upload the post, your videos, your images, your experiments, whatever you can upload into that. These are the different parts of the Foldscope kit. And there is an official website known as Microcosmos. As we see at micro level, there is a cosmos. So all the Foldscope users, they upload their posts onto the Microcosmos website. And the Foldscope team, they continuously guide you. They encourage you with their replies and with their comments on this Microcosmos website, including Manuprakash, he himself. They continuously guide you how to proceed further. They will reply to your posts. So you can try. Maybe the first picture may not be clear. Even then, just give a trial. Say, this is my first image of the Foldscope. They will guide you how to proceed further. And this Foldscope journey, it is moving from the hands of the students to the scientists, academicians, field level, each and everywhere. And the same can be used as a dark field microscope as well as bright field microscopy also. Because you are the curious cubist, you can try in many ways. So here, the video tutorials are available. Just go to Microcosmos website, and in the search box, you type what sort of post you want. You can get that. This is a focus locking. It is a post by Manuprakash, where you can convert this Foldscope into a dark phase and bright field microscope. And this is other post by Manuprakash. You can watch individual bacteria. a bacillus maybe by using Foldscope. How you can do that? That is a post by Manu Prakash. This is an individual bacteria photo, a bacillus. And this is official website of Microcosmos. If you see, there are different terms. Getting started, it explains you about how to get started with Foldscope and all. And then what is Foldscope? If you want to learn about what is Foldscope, how it functions, and so on, it gives detailed information. Buy Foldscope. If you want to buy through official Foldscope instrument site, it will take you. But like as on today, we need to pay in dollars through PayPal or something. Again, there is shipping charges. The Foldscope kits are not available as single piece. We need to buy at least 20 Foldscope kit. That is $35. Again, shipping $35. Again, customs 3,000 rupees. So that's why I said you can have your own single piece from either Amazon or Flipkart. And video assembly tutorials are there. Once you purchase or once you have your Foldscope, how to assemble, how to attach to the mobile, how to prepare the slide, and so all those will be there in that video. Where you can use this? Once you go through the Microcosmos, you can see how people are using, and the other is your curiosity. How curious you can think, how creative you can, that depends on your usage of Foldscope.
Hi friends, I'm Tulasi.
Arunan sir asked me also to prepare a video.
I want to share my experiences on Foldscope as educational and research tool. Foldscope is a paper microscope assembled from a sheet of paper, magnetic couplers and a lens invented by Indian-born scientist Manu Prakash. It weighs 8 grams and provides magnification of 140 times when observed with eye directly. The magnification can be increased when attached to a mobile phone. I am using Foldscope as a tool to explain and show biological concepts like plant cell, animal cell, verticilla, paramecium, bar body, stomata, TS of stem, pollen grains, panipuri water, lactobacillus incurred, drainage water sample, and many more unknown organisms too. To elaborate euglena and paramecium culture and observation with Foldscope, I have collected green moss deposited near the drain pipe, scraped the green moss onto a petri dish, added some tap water, and kept it open for 48 hours and prepared a slide. For preparation of slide, I have cleaned the slide, took a drop of the sample collected onto the slide, cover it with cover slip, and unlike general microscopes, in Foldscope, the sample should be placed inverted in position, means the cover slip should face downwards towards the lens. So in order to prevent the falling of the cover slip, I am sticking the cover slip on either side with cello tape so that the middle part of the slide will be visible and clear. So I kept the cello tape carefully and now placing the slide in the Foldscope for observation in an inverted position so that the sample face the lens. And for observation, I am using my mobile phone, the light source available from China Bazaar. I fixed it onto a cotton box for the support of the Foldscope. Now I attached the Foldscope with the mobile phone, open the camera in the mobile phone, adjust the sample onto the visible area, adjust the focus raft and zoom the picture so that you get a clear and beautiful image. I observed paramecium, euglena and many other microorganisms like amoeba, rotifers with this sample. Thank you.
Like I'll just go through, this is a rotifer, you can observe many of this. Yeah, like as you are the cubist, you keep on working this, on this. For the normal water samples and all, you can use the plain slide, place a drop as you have seen in the procedure. If you want to observe some live organisms like ant or a moena or something, use cavity slides for that. These are, you can use the same to study the pollen also, the pollen grains of the flowers. And the light sources, different light sources, you can use natural light source, a Foldscope LED light like this, or a small torch light, or your cell phone light, or a table lamp, any artificial light. But you need to adjust the intensity of the light like this. A Foldscope light, or a torch light, or a table lamp, anything can be used. Attached to a cotton box, or you can keep torch light in between your books, and you can use that as a light source here. So adjust that and take a image. Or table lamp, just place something, place a glass on that, and from keep your light below the glass so that it is transparent. Place your Foldscope on this and you can observe. And how to change the angle of the light? It is just by holding your hand, changing the position of the light, you can change the angle of light. And if it is you're using your table lamp, you can move or you can increase and decrease the height of the light so that the intensity decreases and you can change the angle of the light. And how to attach to your mobile phone to take cameras? Attach the coupler to your mobile phone by face. Black color should face you. Each coupler consists of two colors, one side silver, one side black. So to attach to your mobile, to take the images, you have to stick in such a way that the black color should face you. The same can be used for the projection. For the projection, the silver color should face you, and you need to attach that to the torch light of the mobile. For the projection, you have to attach to the torch light, and silver color should face you. And you can measure this, and there is a post available on how to measure the size. This is, you can just search in the microcosmos how to measure the Foldscope by using the Foldscope, the size of the object. You can learn from this. So how to assemble the Foldscope and all, the videos are available in YouTube. How to prepare the slide, how to assemble. This is what, thank you. This is my number and mail ID. If any of you, while using, if you have any doubt, you can call me. Because it needs some patience, it needs some practice. You won't get images, videos like this instantly tomorrow. So you need to practice a lot. If you have any doubt, you can call me. You can mail me.
Thanks, ma'am.
Thank you.
So I think ma'am has an question for all the QBs sitting out here, right? So I think somewhere in that presentation, ma'am asked, how would you use the Foldscope?
Yes.
Right, so I think QBs should be able to answer this. So anyone, so with whatever work that you have done, how would you put a full Foldscope to use?
Yesterday even we tried most of the samples from Meghalaya.
Yes.
We collected the soil samples from Meghalaya and observed most of the organisms which were present there. Rotifer and yesterday
ciliates.
Ciliates, yes. Which we
yesterday observed. Yesterday we observed the ciliates. We took the videos of ciliates. Mm. We took the videos of rotifers.
Usually what happens when we want to see a organism like nematodes, we are working on nematodes. So usually when we go for a compound microscope, we usually take photos and videos out of it, and our hand shakes. It's very difficult to take a video on a compound microscope. So yesterday when I was working with Foldscope with ma'am, I felt it was very easy to take videos of it. So yes, I guess even I asked Sarita ma'am to bring buy some Foldscopes for our lab.
Yesterday itself he said, we are going to have one in the lab. That's true. So I'll be waiting for the videos.
Yes, ma'am, surely.
The Cube group. Thank you.
Thanks, ma'am. So now I would like to call on stage the Cardamine group to give their presentation. So all are there in the Cardamine group?
हेलो ध्यान दो इधर क्या कौन सा है
कार्डामिन टू
क्या
कहाँ देख रहे हो
क्या
ऐसे ध्यान दो क्या इधर बताइए सर अभी बोले
Good evening, everyone. My name is Shama Banu Sayed. I am from CHM College. We are going to present Cardamine. First, we'll play the video. We have been making this video for long two days, and now we have cut and edited everything. So, have a look. There are we have been
Hello everyone. We have been cultured cardamine for 2 days, and we have prepared a movie on it. We observed the long-term and short-term objectives of cardamine, and I'm going to introduce to you to everyone. I'm Sneha. This is Sushant sir, Sanjana, Drishya, Zaid, and Shamadi. Okay, now we are going to play our movie.
Those plants which are of no use can be said as
This was the video based on cardamine, introducing the plant and how to culture it and know the properties about cardamine. That's all. First of all, you should be very confident of what you have done. This is not a public show. It is a very total academic interaction we are having. So I'm just talking as a mentor. Just relax and please express whatever we are doing in a very confident way. There was no culture. I think you were talking about a model plant. So be confident in whatever you express and relax and please communicate confidently. That is very important. You people are doing an awesome job. So it was not audible. Can you please explain it again on the mic? Sir can do it or any of you so that the audience could understand. The thing was not audible, the video. Okay. actually there were two people who didn't know about the uses of cardamine because they were using it as a weed which is edible for some other purpose. We said chutney. I introduce.
ठीक है.
हाँ. So I talked about it. Then our one of the friend who is working in cardamine. So she introduced the plant and its uses and how it is used as a plant model system. So
you explained its importance.
Yeah,
its morphological identification points.
Yeah,
and where it grows and what is its importance as a model plant. That's it.
Yeah, and then one of them asked that there are other plant model system or what. So she said that I have heard about Arabidopsis, but we don't know. I don't know much about it. So she went to her professor, and her professor.
So asked, is cardamine and Arabidopsis the same thing, sir?
Well, ma'am. Actually, these are two very close relative plants, belong to the same family, Brassica family. And both plants are diploid in nature. Arabidopsis has 6 pairs of chromosomes, and mostly cardamine has 5 pairs of chromosomes. So
both plants are diploid in nature?
Diploid. Both are diploid plants. These are both are belong to the same family. And in fact, cardamine is an emerging plant in model system. Actually, I have not done any work with cardamine, but it is available in our northeastern states.
What is the significance of studying this model system?
Well, it has a very short genome that can be studied in genetics, like other model organisms, and it has a short lifespan, almost 40 days, so we can use it as a model plant in our cube labs also. It is already using here, but we are not actually conducting any experiment on it till now.
Thank you.
So I have a question. So what question you want to address using cardamine as a model system in near future? Like, is there a long-term objective?
Yeah, but now we are not clear about it. So we didn't portray anything related to that. But we want to address. First, we have to start with culturing. How we are going to culture moina? Cardamine.
So moina culture is famous, sir.
So how we are going to culture cardamine with in a one leaflet stage, from three leaflet stage, from five leaflet stage, from seven leaflet stage, and then from seed. How we are going to do that, and also we are planning to conduct some experiments which are related to that floral dip method. We have just heard about it. We haven't researched or searched anything related to it. We are in the initial stage of cardamine. So
I think that the culturing of cardamine, as far as cube is concerned, someone has already, you know, have established protocol with respect to the culturing. So yeah. Are you looking for some alternate prospects of culturing? Like, are you going to make culturing more easier, or what? Like, it should not be, like, according to me, it should not be just a repetitive task if you're taking it as a cube group. So yeah. If you're taking it as a cube group, first you know, obviously you'll replicate what they did and you'll yeah. culture it. But then are there objectives in your mind that, you know?
I'm saying that only we are in a very initial stage. We just know about cardamine right now. And for 3 days we have been working, not more than that. So, and we have been making this video and all stuff. So that's why.
So Shama, are you the first people who are starting the cardamine study?
Or no.
There
no.
are some known literature to you which has done some work
yeah.
on cardamine. So why don't you tell a little bit about that?
I haven't searched yet about it. Huh.
There is a very recent paper which one of my students actually showed 2 days before I came here, which said that if you expose cardamine to different temperatures, higher temperature, the petals stop growing. So this sort of morphological changes can be studied by exposing them to different environmental conditions, and then study, and then we can go back and see which gene is being affected by that. See, so many morphological, so many of these physiological pathways can be worked out. So this can be, their intention is to develop this as a model plant because it grows all over India and all from all parts of the country. QBs can perform small experiments and give that data. So that will become a huge data and yes, we can actually come up with some very important concepts.
There is in Mumbai there is only seven leaflet stage of cardamine found in Mumbai region, but one of our colleague Sneha had got a 9 leaflet stage cardamine plant in Delhi because of there are very lower temperature, so they grow very well in that. I want to show that pic. This is 9 stage, 9 leaflet stage.
Shama, Didi, you said you want to grow 9 leaf stage seed, 4 leaf stage and 4 leaf stage plant. Why are you doing that, and like, how are you going to do that, and why are you doing that?
Where's the slide? Just open it.
I wanted to see that are we able to repot and culture moina? Sorry.
She earlier used to culture moina, so maybe that's why.
Video went. We had our PPT.
So very close related to this cardamine is Arabidopsis thaliana. So people must have read and studied about this plant. And some years before the paper from Germany, Max Planck Institute, the scientists and group did some experiment with that. So this cardamine has a compound leaf and the Arabidopsis has a simple leaf. So with just one gene mutation, there is one gene called RCO. They just did one gene mutation, and because of that, the simple leaf got little bit feature of the compound leaf. And just by doing this simple, and to do mutation and create transgenic in Arabidopsis is actually not that difficult. You can just dip the flower into the solution which has bacteria with the DNA, and it can take, and then the seeds you can just sow, and then the transgenic plants can come, and you can just select and breed that plants. So it's very easy actually to culture and to ask genetic level of question in Arabidopsis. So the same thing you can do with the cardamine also. So that is what may be the future object.
Whether it works. See, floral dip is something that has worked only for Brassicaceae members, that too Arabidopsis and Brassica. So it's not known to work in any other plant. So cardamine being a Brassicaceae member can be tried. So this is another project which QBs can take up. And they can just say whether it works or not. After that, we can find out about whether genes can get inside, whether we can actually genetically engineer plants or not. That can come follow.
As sir said, there is a particular gene called Nox gene, K-N-O-X gene, and that gene is mainly in Arabidopsis. It is limited to a particular region called shoot apical meristem, but in cardamine, this gene is the reason for for the formation of that leaflet pattern. So while looking at Arabidopsis, we can see such leaflet modifications. It's such a simple leaf. While in Cardamine, by the presence of that particular gene, KNOX gene, the leaflet pattern is seen. But in Arabidopsis, that gene is limited to shoot apical meristem.
Coming back to Aarti, we are doing the plants. We are repotting it because we found a cardamine in garden area. So we wanted to see that if we uproot it and plant it anywhere else, are they able to grow again? Or we have to always grow with the seed, because it will take a little bit more time when we do with seed. So we wanted to do that. That's all. Bola na. Ha. I said.
She's supposed to reduce time by taking 5-leafed or 3-leafed leaflet stages.
Cardamine has also medicinal uses. Cardamine hirsuta, this is the species. We can use it in medical. I've read that this is used for anxiety, for reducing anxiety. And I'm not sure, but there were many medicinal uses of cardamine hirsuta. Well, I don't remember it clearly for now.
Okay, proceed to the next. Okay, thanks.
We can also call it plant for future.
Okay. Okay, so the next group that we call is the group that has worked on the role of seed coat. Can you all come to the stage?
So hello everyone, I'm Dhanushri Bagul from Elphiston College Fort, and I have Pooja Davarkar with me. She is also from Elphiston College Fort, and we have few more members in our group.
Hello, my name is Arushi Jain. I'm doing BSc Life Science from Dayal Singh College, Delhi University.
Hello, I'm Vaishnavi KP from SN College Natika, Trishur Kannur, Kerala district, and I'm doing MSc in first year.
So we are working on to check the role of seed coat in seed germination, and we have prepared a video on it. So here's our video.
एक के बाद
हां ठीक है
So here in this video, we have made different types of concentration and one control plain plate agar to check the salinity stress on seed germination, the role of seed coat in seed germination. We have also prepared one PPT.
These are our introduction I've already given. So our short-term objective was to check the effect of different salt concentrations on the mung seeds, which are with the seed coat or without seed coat. And in future, we'll study the proteins that are present in the seed coat, which help the seed to grow even in stress conditions. So first, we measured the length of the radical after germination. And there's also a video of how we measured the radical length. So,
this is how we measure the length of the radical using the graph paper. So as we all know, the graph paper is divided into equal boxes. Each box measures 1 centimeter, and the 1 centimeter box is further divided into small boxes, which measures 1 millimeter. So we place the seeds onto the box of 1 centimeter, and we count the number of small boxes in which the radical falls. So by doing this, we measure the length of the curved part of the radical.
So this is the observation that we get. We can see when we, in the plain agar, there's a length of 0.9 centimeters and 0.8 centimeters of the radical. So overall, we can observe when we increase the salt concentration as the stress, like in 50 millimolar concentration, the length of the radical decreases. And again, in the 100 millimolar, the length decreases further. So we can conclude that when the stress condition increases, the seed coat is helping the seed not to germinate on increasing the stress conditions. So after observing the radicals, we noticed that 100 millimolar concentration, the radicals are emerging from the seed, but of shorter length. So that is very interesting for us. We think that certain proteins may be present in the seed coat, which help the seed from the stress condition, and that we provided, for example, different salinity conditions. And in future, we are looking forward to find out different types of proteins involved.
Yeah, can you come back to the table, please? Yeah, so in this table, if we see, so there is a slight variability, but if you can figure out the mean of seeds with seed coat and seeds without seed coat. So in plain agar, you see that there is not much of difference. So you're saying that, so you are stating here two things. First of all, the effect of salt concentration on the germination of the radical. And second, the importance of seed coat. So the effect of salt, I can clearly see. We'll talk about it later. But how can you, in a control situation, say from this data that the seed coat is important or is not important? Like, just look at your data. And how can you conclude that it is important or not important?
No, we are not stating it's important or not. We are using it to study the protein present in the seed coat, because we are providing stress. And so from the data, we haven't calculated mean, I agree, but from this data, we can say ki seed coat is helping the seed, it's helping the seed not to germinate when we are providing stress. So there must be some protein.
But seeds with seed coat, the average is around, say, 0.95 in your control, or 0.9 centimeter, because there are 6 readings, as I can see. 4 of them are 0.8, and two of them are 0.9, right? So the mean comes somewhere between 0.85, let's say. Seeds without the seed coat, their read is around like 0.9 or more than 0.9 itself. So here the seeds without the seed coat and the seeds with the seed coats are almost like growing the radical to the same extent in the in your controls. Like if seed is not allowed, if seed coat is doing anything to the germination of the radical or germination of the seed itself, you should see some difference, right?
So for that we have to check the germination rate. We have to take two different hours, seed in two different hours, soaked in different hours.
Yes, like, so that is what I was trying to push you towards. Like,
okay.
What is the basis of your statement that it affects the, like, have you read it in literature or are you going to do a time point sequence where you will prove that, you know, if it has a seed coat, it takes this much time to get out of the seed coat, and by that time, the seed without the seed coat is already has grown 0.5 centimeters per se. Like, let's
say. I don't think there's a paper on the length of the radical, but what I've read was there was a paper which said the dead seed coat also have some proteins for the hydrolyting enzyme.
Coming to the protein part is a different issue. I'm asking, let's only talk about seed is a covering. Seed coat is a covering. So you want to prove when it's inside and germinating, you want to tell us. So one thing is we must just buy your statement because you're saying it and we believe that seed is a covering, so radical will come out late. But are you planning to do a time course series on it where you show that, or like, is there a basis of your statement? Because your statement should come from experimental evidence, right?
Okay.
Because on the basis of your end results, what I could figure out is whether it has a seed coat or it do not have a seed coat, the final length of the radical is going to
almost
be the same. So it's not going to affect the final length of the radical that we know from your result in the controls.
So I think for now we have put the time constant and we just measure the length of the radical. So I think in the future we'll check the germination rate also, it's growing or not.
And also, so for all these readings, when you finally measure the radical length, like the time of the incubation of the seed inside the agar is same, right?
Mm.
How much is it?
12 hours.
12 hours. You take all the readings after 12 hours.
Yeah, that's why I said the time is constant. Yeah. So that was it, I think. Thank you, everybody. Oh, there's a concept map also. So we can relate to, we wanted to say that we are not just related to, limited to botany. We can connect to very different fields also by seed germination. We can go to biophysics also, to biotech also. And we are checking the temperature, pressure conditions, different climatic conditions. So ecology is also involved. And similarly, you can see the plant physiology, biochemistry, biostatistics, because we are measuring the length of the radical. And we'll do the mean. We'll do the mean also. So yes.
So as we were doing the experiment, there were many goof-ups made by us. First, we used to measure the length of the radical using a scale. So we did not get the exact accurate measurement as we couldn't measure the curved part of it. So after that, we realized, like Shamadi said us, that you can measure it on a graph paper, as you can keep the seed on the graph paper and you can actually measure the squares in which the radical falls, so you can get the measurement.
Yeah, but a graph paper is equivalent of a scale only.
But the thing is, if we put the seed besides the scale, so we can't measure the curved part, right? How will you
measure the curved part in the graph? Isn't it another good alternative of measuring curved surfaces?
Yeah.
What is it? Can we use a thread?
Yeah, even that.
So have you tried using a thread?
We haven't done it with a thread because as we had, when I came on Thursday over here, so she said me ki rather than measuring it with a scale, you can use a graph, and which would be an easy way.
I don't see how a graph is like helping the purpose of it instead of a scale. I think a thread would have been a better option where you can actually, you know, just let the thread be along the curved part and then you can measure the thread. Just make markings on the thread.
Okay.
And just measure the thread. It's
so
equivalent.
So yeah, we next time check out with it. So, and the second thing was like, first of all, we used tap water for soaking the seeds when we were checking the salinity stress. So afterwards, when we realized that even the tap water would have its own salinity, so that's why where we used distilled water for our experiment. So this is where we are done. Thank you.
Any questions to them? We'll be breaking for snacks very quickly. So any questions you have? OK, anyone questions?
Who has the question? So no questions?
What else will you do with this system in future?
Can you
plan to do?
Okay, ma'am, we'll extract the proteins. We'll check that different proteins are involved. And my senior.
No, we'll announce the award.
In the seed coat, yes. And we'll see if the proteins are in the seed coat are secreting during germinating or not.
What is the purpose of knowing about the protein? Like you say, you want to know the protein being produced in the seed coat. Jabki legumes mein proteins are there, it's a rich source, every place has protein, right? So why you are talking of proteins in the seed coat? Has it some role in the dormancy or the germination? What protein are you talking about?
Also to like narrow down what ma'am is saying, there'll be thousands of proteins.
Thousands of proteins.
Now, so have you read enough and have you narrowed down some proteins of interest?
So there'll be thousands of protein because proteins are everywhere in each and every cells and legumes are source of high proteins. So there'll be thousands of protein, but have you read and you have narrowed down to certain proteins which you know that are important for this or that function which we'll be looking at? Because if you go randomly looking at proteins, you'll get a data set so big enough that people's PhD go into it. Years will go into it just analyzing the number of proteins. And first thing is, how are you going to do this? Second thing, are there target proteins you are targeting? Or is it all random?
No, I haven't targeted any protein. We're just looking at the types, category of protein through the SDS page we used earlier. So,
okay, the category of proteins, where do you think is the molecular level, the cotyledons are the source of high rich protein, right? The seed coat is just having a very minimal level. So what type of protein are you going to study? Are you're not clear. You should have a clear question, what Arunan sir says.
So
what is the question?
That's what we are checking. We are not just checking it for the cotyledon. We are checking for the proteins present in the seed coat.
Proteins present in the seed coat?
Seed coat, yeah.
There are many in a legume seed coat. What is the importance of it? Like, why? What is...
No, it's...
And they're just to protect. Physical protection. So now there was recently a paper where they have actually said that even these dead seed coats have proteins, and they actually allow the seeds to persist. They help the seed to persist in the soil. So, but not in all. Most of the seed coats are dead, and they do not generally have any proteins.
Thanks. Any question?
Yes, yes, she's, ma'am is saying, right? Yeah, in the hydrolytic enzymes get activated. When they're hydrolyzed, the proteins get activated in the seed coat. They help in retaining the dormancy of the seed. Like you keep the seed for years together without moisture and providing it the right germination condition. But the moment you provide it moisture, water, the enzyme activity in the seed coat begins too.
Yes, ma'am.
So, no. Inside the cotyledons, then followed by the seed coat. Andar se bahar.
That is what they were saying, that they have not a, this not a passive protection that the seed coat provides. It actually is an active protection by degrading the microbes themselves. So now the concept, no, it's not living. The cells are dead, but they have the enzymes there preserved. So when the requirement is there, the proteins are secreted out and they ward off the microbial attack or whatever. Or even they help in stress condition somehow. Okay, so that is what actually made them take up the project, just to check whether these proteins are there and how are they acting.
Yes.
Okay, after maybe 24 hours, are they still there? They are secreted out.
Why do you think that seed coat is so much interesting to you?
What makes seed coat interesting? Can you tell me what fascinates you?
About the seed coat?
Yeah.
So we can, if we find some proteins, we can isolate them for our use also, no?
Is that the objective?
Yeah, that's what you said, right?
Is that the objective?
No, not dormancy, but if we are finding proteins, we are extracting proteins, we can isolate them also from the seed coat also. Yes.
And understand the role, right?
Yeah, understand the role.
That way. Okay, good.
Okay, so now we'll be breaking for the snack session, but it is only we are breaking for 10 minutes because we don't have much time. And we have an awards giving session after this. So please come soon. Only 10 minutes, please arrive soon. Yeah.
Thank you. Special thanks to Chitra.